The topic for my presentation today is immediate loading, the Indian perspective. So why are we talking about immediate loading? If you're looking at, from the patient's point of view, it's like giving patients immediate function and their immediate aesthetic requirement. Also from the patient's point of view, it is a much reduced treatment duration. As far as the clinician is concerned, the benefits for the clinician is it is a huge practice builder. These days, there is a need for speed, and most patients would love their treatment to get done in the shortest possible time and to have fixed teeth as soon as possible. And apart from that, the motivation also is that it can be quite financially rewarding once the cases are well executed. So immediate loading interest, amongst clinicians is at an all-time high. But there's one thing that we all as clinicians should understand, that if we were to categorize all the cases that we treat in implant dentistry into straightforward, advanced and complex, the immediate loading for full arch implant supported restorations would definitely fall in the complex category. So in today's presentation, apart from talking about the science of immediate loading, I would actually like to bring in a bit of an Indian perspective to this subject. You know, as we all know, in a country as diverse as ours, we have various levels of practices across the nation. So most of the practices, I would actually categorize them as fairly modest practices. At the same time, there is, there are in some of the big cities, very high-end practices, which will probably rival any good practice anywhere in the world. You should also remember that there are remote practices. There are certain, small towns and, I may even call them villages, where there are, some very good clinicians. There are practices there. But what we need to understand is there are certain logistical issues that come in the way of providing the patients the right kind of treatment options. So depending upon the geographical location, there are few situations or few logistical problems that clinicians might face. For instance, the CBCT availability, the availability of having a good cone beam CT scan center close to your practice. And we all know that these days, with especially when we are executing complex cases, you cannot do a good implant treatment plan without a good CBCT. So having a good CBCT center close to your office is of great importance. Apart from that, the implant component supply, how soon and how briskly the components are going to be available to that particular clinician is also of importance. And the last thing is the lab support. We know that at times clinicians take more than a week to just simply deliver their work to a good lab. So not having some kind of a lab support close to your practice might actually be quite detrimental in offering certain treatment options to the patients. So having said that, what I propose doing during this presentation is, talk about various treatment options for doing full arch immediate loading restorations. But at the same time, give some kind of clinical recommendations or some guidance to clinicians who are practicing in different situations across the country. And maybe tailor-make or customize certain treatment solutions for their patients because of this slight limitation that they may face. Let's jump into the subject on immediate loading. So first, let's understand what the different loading protocols exist in implant dentistry. So we've been talking about immediate loading. So immediate loading by definition is a restoration that gets fixed over the implants within 1 week of the implant placement. The early loading is something which will happen between 1 week to 2 months time after the implants have been placed. And conventional healing, as we all know, is a restoration that is going to be placed over the implant anytime after 2 months. This is the most widely accepted classification. So when we are talking about immediate loading, we will pretty much stick to this concept, which is placing a restoration over the implant within a week after the implant has been placed. But again, when we're talking about placing a restoration, there is going to be a variation in this concept. So when we are looking at immediate loading, as we popularly call it, so immediate loading is only when there is going to be some kind of a functional load over the implants. Okay, like as you see over here, this is a case of a full arch maxillary prosthesis that has been placed over the implants. And as we all know, when we place a full arch restoration, you are going to have functional load over it. It's impossible to keep a full arch restoration out of occlusion. Whereas if you look at implants that have been placed immediately, maybe in an extraction socket and a provisional restoration has been provided on the same day, you could call that as an immediate restoration, wherein there is no occlusal load over the restoration that has been placed immediately over the implant. So as you see, this is the patient's existing tooth, which is in functional occlusion, and this is the implant-supported provisional restoration, where you can clearly see on the palatal side there has been adequate clearance given so that there is no occlusal load on that particular restoration until the time osseointegration occurs. With this in mind, let's step ahead and see what are the basic requirements for immediate loading for full arch restorations. So number one is that you want to have good distribution of implants. As you see on this image on the right side, you want to have implants that are placed all the way across the arch from molar to molar. You want good primary stability for all the implants. I'll very soon talk a bit about stability of implants. But primary stability for immediate loading of restorations over implants is mandatory. Should also look at getting good cross arch stabilization. So for that, you need to have the implants, like I've said, placed uniformly across the arch, so that the implant from one side helps to support the implants on the contralateral side once a rigid prosthesis is fixed over it. In the provisional restoration, there should be no cantilevers. So your initial treatment plan may account for certain cantilever in the final restoration. But in the provisional restoration, you should not have any cantilever which will have detrimental forces on the implants while they are healing. One of the most important aspects of immediate loading is to make a restoration that is completely retrievable, which means that the restoration has to be screw retained in nature. So no cement retained restorations are made as a provisional restoration in the immediate loading protocol. The reason behind it is that it has to be very easily retrieved once the implants are osseointegrated, and then when we want to move from the provisional to the final restoration. The restoration that gets designed should be easy to maintain. It has to have a convex intaglio surface, as you see over here in this particular case. And which can be very easily maintained by the patient at their end, especially when the implants are being placed and you have a surgical wound and you're placing a restoration immediately over it, either on that day of the surgery. It's important to design the restoration in such a way that the patient finds it easy to maintain the underside of that restoration. Let's talk a little bit about implant stability. As we know, implant stability is classified into primary stability and secondary stability. So what exactly is primary stability? So primary stability is something that we achieve at the time when we insert the implant in the bone. So as we all know, the implants are almost wedged tightly into the native bone. And when we do that, the implant is at its maximum stability. So for that particular implant, when you place it in the bone immediately at the time of surgery, you will see that you have 100% stability at the time of placement. But watch what happens as the weeks roll by. So in fact, in the first week after the implant has been placed, you will see that there isn't really much loss in stability. So the first 1 week, the implant is almost as stable as it is on day one. And for that reason, immediate loading is always done within this window period of 1 week. Having said that, it is best if you can do it as soon as possible. So in practice, we usually restrict this to the first 48 to 72 hours after the implant placement. During that period, your implant will have its maximum stability and you can actually take advantage of that situation and manipulate the implant to some extent by screwing and unscrewing some of the components that you may need to do while placing the restoration. Now watch this graph, watch as it starts to move on to week 3 and week 4. You notice that the primary stability which you had on day 1 has dropped down to less than 50%, and that is quite significant. Now this is again an important aspect and a tip to clinicians is never to ever manipulate any of the implant components during this window period. So this period between 3 weeks to 4 weeks is actually extremely critical, and that is a time when the implant needs maximum rest within the bone, and any manipulation of trying to screw or unscrew any components over the implants or trying to make an impression at that point on time and trying to deliver a prosthesis at that point during the 3 to 4 week can be quite hazardous, and we may actually lose the osseointegration over that implant. Now let's look at the secondary stability. Now on the day of the implant is placed, the secondary stability is zero. But as the days roll by and as you go into the following weeks, you see that the secondary stability starts to rise. Now, what exactly is secondary stability? Now, secondary stability is something that is going to be achieved with the process of osseointegration. So, as we all know, once the titanium surface is within the bone, the process of osseointegration is going to begin. And as you see in this particular graph, the blue line as it starts to ascend, in the third, fourth week, it is still not reached adequate amount of osseointegration. But as you reach the week 6, you see that you are almost at 60-70% of the desired osseointegration that you need for that particular implant. So which means that at week 6, you could possibly start to do some kind of a loading protocol on those implants, which could ideally be categorized as an early placement protocol. And week 8, you will see that most implant surfaces these days will allow complete stability to occur by around 8 weeks. So for that reason, after around 8 weeks, it is good to load most of the implants that we place these days in modern day implant dentistry. Again, the primary stability that we achieve on day 1 usually comes from the macro geometry of the implant. So the threads of the implant, and so for that reason these days most of the modern implant designs have a lot of aggressive thread options. The reason for that is most clinicians now want to achieve maximum primary stability on the day of the implant placement, and many of those would actually land up getting restored immediately, or some might even get loaded immediately. The secondary stability is something which comes from the surface of the implant, so the surface treatment that is done over the implant. And again, over there, within the implant implant systems, you will have a variation wherein certain implant surfaces allow a much faster rate of osseointegration. So in those implant systems, you will probably be able to load, if you are planning a final restoration over that implant, you could probably load those much earlier than we would do in the olden days when, they were all machine surfaces with no surface treatment at all. So this graph, according to me, has a huge importance in the whole concept of immediate loading, and to also understand the timelines on when it is safe to manipulate the implants and when it becomes unsafe to try and do any kind of manipulation over the implants. So if you look at it in this graph, the first 1 week is when we are going to work on our immediate restoration, and it's only after week 6 or in most of the times after week 8 we are going to look at doing the definitive restoration. How do we measure implant stability? So traditionally we have been measuring implant stability by using our torque wrenches, and we all know that you need an adequate amount of torque if one has to load that implant immediately. So the torque values are measured, and usually 30 to 40 Newton centimeters is what we are looking for to have good torque values for full arch implant supported restorations if you plan to immediately load these implants. When you're doing a single tooth in the aesthetic zone in the anterior maxilla, you're really looking at something like 40 to 50 Newton centimeter, which is going to be slightly higher if you're looking at loading a single tooth, restoring a single tooth in the arch. The other way of measuring stability is using the ISQ devices. So devices like Austell or Penguin, which actually give you a numerical reading. And based on the numerical reading, we can, make our assessment whether that implant is fit enough for being loaded or not. So if you look at the values, anything which shows you a reading of over 70 on the ISQ would be considered to be safe for loading. So which means that when we place the implants and we want to do an immediate loading of that for a full arch case, you need to check the Austell or the Penguin reading and the ISQ value and make an assessment whether all those implants are stable enough for us to fix a functional restoration over those implants on the day of the surgery. Which are the indications for immediate loading and immediate restorations? So if you look at full arch cases, the full arch maxilla or the full arch mandibular cases with equal distribution of implants all around are suitable cases for immediate loading. Whereas when you're looking at immediate restorations, we become a little more selective. So the selectiveness comes from whether we are doing it in the anterior or posterior part of the mouth. So enough studies have shown that high success rates of doing immediate restorations of non-functional loading of those implants in the aesthetic zone. So whether it's the maxillary or the mandibular anteriors, placing implants and giving the patient a provisional restoration, which does not have occlusal contacts, is a highly acceptable treatment modality. We also need to understand which are the situations that need to be completely avoided. And for that, the single teeth posteriors or multiple teeth or quadrants in the posteriors, sites which have been grafted, either doing a GBR or a sinus lift procedure, these are the cases where, we don't load those implants immediately. In literature also, there is not enough evidence in favor of doing immediate loading in these kind of clinical situations. So in my practice too, I never land up giving the patient either a functional or a non-functional restoration in any of these clinical situations. Apart from this, we also have to consider other parameters, the amount of bone volume. Immediate loading is to be done only when there is adequate amount of bone for placing implants and achieving the desired primary stability. Also, anatomical factors where the sinuses are, the nasal floor and the inferior alveolar nerve, whether those are actually coming in the way of getting good sized implants and whether they are coming in the way of achieving good primary stability for our implants have to be considered. Sometimes there are unfavorable, interarch relationships between the maxilla and the mandible. Now, at times we see that we have a highly constricted or a resorbed maxilla and, mandible which has perhaps a full extent of teeth. Now, this becomes highly unfavorable if we are planning to place implants in this highly constricted maxilla and then give the patient a full arch implant-supported restoration immediately on the day of the surgery. So this becomes a bit of a risk factor. Apart from this, we have to look at patients' psyche also. There are some patients who have unreasonable expectations out of the treatment that we offer them. So some of these patients might actually not comply with the dietary restrictions that you impose on them after doing an immediate loading case. So that again becomes a case to avoid. Patients with poor compliance who are not going to maintain hygiene, who are not going to follow up properly, or again patients who are not candidates for doing immediate loading cases. But above all, the number one situation where I feel clinicians should not attempt immediate loading is if they lack the adequate experience in performing such cases. So immediate loading is not for beginners. It's only when you have got fairly comfortable in your implant journey, have done a few conventional cases of loading during your career, that's when you start moving towards doing immediate loading, particularly for full arch restorations. Let's talk a bit about risk factors now. There are certain risk factors that we need to consider when we are doing immediate loading. The general health and the age of the patient is an important aspect. We know that full arch restorations are usually done for aged patients, but when you're planning to do something which is like an immediate loading on that over those implants, you need to understand that we need to have a patient who is reasonably comfortable to sit on the dental chair for an extended period of time. because these procedures are quite time intensive, and at times very old patients are unable to keep their themselves motivated to sit on the dental chair for that many hours at length, and oftentimes that comes in the way of giving them the desired treatment that we start off planning for. Adequate mouth opening is again extremely important while doing these full arch cases, particularly when we look at doing guided surgery cases. You need to have adequate mouth opening for to be able to place the stents in the mouth, to be able to place the implants in the right inclinations and the directions. So patients with limited mouth opening, large tongues, less flexibility of the cheeks are actually in a way, I would say, relative contraindications for performing these procedures. Patients with frank infections, periapical infections or periodontal infections, I won't say are absolute contraindications, but certainly a risk factor for placing implants immediately and loading them on the same day. You know, patients such as these who've got, some kind of a parafunction, who actually had dentition like this, which was completely worn out. And you can imagine the amount of occlusal load that these patients must be subjecting to on the dentition. Now, if these patients needed extractions of all the teeth and implants, and then implant-supported restorations, placing a restoration immediately over the implants on the day of placement again would be a risk factor in such patients. So though you might have adequate amount of bone to place the implants and get primary stability, sometimes the occlusal load that these patients exert over these restorations can be quite detrimental to the health of the implants. I would like to urge you, all of you to look at this article that we published this year. It's called the ABCD classification, and it actually is a comprehensive philosophy of treatment planning full arch edentulous arches. What we have basically done is made a classification which has four different factors which we will consider during treatment planning for fully edentulous patients. So the age of the patients, the bone zones where the available bone is, the cosmetic display, that is the lip line that the patient has, as well as the amount of resorption that has taken place of the alveolus, is all considered while deciding on what type of approach, on what type of prosthesis has to be designed for this particular case, whether it's a removable denture or whether it's a fixed, or if it's a fixed, what's going to be the type of prosthesis. It's going to be like a FP1, FP2, FP3 prosthesis, or whether it's the material that we're going to choose for this, whether it's going to be a ceramic based prosthesis or an acrylic based prosthesis or a PEEK based prosthesis. So all this is very comprehensively described in this particular journal article. You know, a typical case in our practice goes through these four phases for fully edentulous patients. So there is an initial planning phase, which is followed by the surgical phase of implant placement. Then there is a phase of a provisional restoration. So whether it is on the day of the implant placement within the first week, or maybe even after osseointegration is done and before going in for the definitive restoration, I usually like to leave the patient with a provisional restoration for a period of time and then convert it to a final restoration. We also have to consider two situations in clinical practice when we are looking at full arch reconstructions. So there are situations where patients have come with an existing set of teeth which need extractions and maybe an implant supported restoration. So in these situations, we are actually looking at doing extractions, placing the implants on the same day, and then doing the immediate loading over those implants. Contrary to that, the other situation is where the patient is completely edentulous, and this edentulous patient perhaps has been wearing a denture in the past, and now we are really looking at placing implants and doing immediate loading for that particular patient. Having said that, these days in practice, I see more of the former situation where patients do come with some existing teeth before they totally become edentulous. And many of those patients are actually good candidates for immediate placements as well as immediate loading of those implants. Let's look at a bit of the initial planning stage that we need to do before going ahead with the surgical phase. Let's look at an edentulous patient such as this who has no maxillary teeth at all, who has been wearing a denture. Now, even if the patient has been wearing an existing denture, what we need to make for a patient is a trial denture. If the patient doesn't have a denture, you start making a denture, or if the patient has an existing denture, you modify the denture. So a trial denture essentially is a one which is made without any labial flange. And the reason for that is when you place that denture in the patient's mouth, you are able to judge whether the patient actually requires that labial flange, for the lip support or not. By providing the patient, a flangeless denture, you are able to assess that. Now, if a patient actually requires that flange for a lip support and for better aesthetics, that patient actually is not a candidate for a fixed maxillary restoration. You would actually, you're better off doing some kind of an overdenture restoration and giving the patient a denture with a flange. So this trial denture helps in making that initial diagnosis. It will also help us to understand what the incisor position is when we are starting off, because that's going to be extremely important when we reach the end point of the particular case. Also, the patient's aesthetic expectations as well as the phonetics needs to be judged with the trial denture. And this trial denture will also to be tested in the patient's mouth in normal speech, with the lips completely at rest, and also in the Duchenne smile, wherein the patient does a highly exaggerated smile for us to actually see how much of the upper lip gets lifted up when the patient smiles or laughs socially. So all this initial assessment has to be done with the trial denture. Apart from that, the trial denture will also help us to fabricate certain tools, certain guides that will help us during the surgical phase of the treatment. So the trial denture will help us in first fabricating a radiographic guide. It will help us in making a surgical stent, which will help us in the surgery. It's also going to help us in making the prosthetic shell, which is going to help us in doing the immediate restoration over the implants. A radiographic stent is nothing but maybe the patient's existing denture or the trial denture, into which you place radiographic markers, which might be just gutta percha, and send the patient to the scanning center to assess how much of bone is present in that particular location. So you might want to place implants maybe in the central incisors, the canines, and the first molar regions. But you also want to know exactly where that location is, which will help you at the time of surgery. So by putting these radiographic markers, it helps us to understand the exact location for that particular implant. The trial denture also helps us to fabricate a surgical stent. The surgical stent will help us assisting us in getting our locations of the implants for the surgeries. There are various different designs and various concepts of surgical stents. What you see over here is perhaps the most basic or the most primitive one. There are also certain visual guides that helps us during surgeries, which will help us to align the implants parallel to each other, or also help us to tilt the implants at a specific angulation, especially when you are looking at doing the tilted implant concept. We also need to have a prosthetic shell ready before the surgery. So prosthetic shell could be the patient's denture that you have fabricated, the trial denture, which eventually becomes the prosthetic shell. Or you could just make a prosthetic shell specifically for that particular case. And the prosthetic shell will help us in making of, basically this denture, which gets converted into a fixed restoration on the day of the implant placement. While placing the implants, there are three different strategies that we use in practice. One is the freehand implant placement. With the help of the visual guides, you place the implants in the bone as per the prosthetic plan. The second, which is the most sophisticated one way of doing it, is to make a CT-guided stent, a surgical stent with the help of the CBCT data, which will give us the exact implant locations and positions, and which will help us to put the implants in an ideal three-dimensional position in the bone based on the initial prosthetic plan. The third one, which is a combination of the two, which is a bit of a we could call it like a semi-guided surgery, wherein part of it is guided for identifying the implant locations and inclinations, and part of the surgery is done freehand. And as we go ahead, I will talk a little bit about this this treatment concept. When it comes to making the provisional restoration over the implants, there are three different strategies again. One strategy is to convert the patient's denture, the removable denture, immediately on the same day chair side and deliver it and fix it over the implants. The second option is the sophisticated one, wherein just the way we have done made a surgical stent for guided surgery, the final restoration is also prefabricated by the lab based on the data that we have provided them. And on the day of the surgery, the implants are placed using the surgical stent, and then the restoration will accurately fit over those implants and gets delivered on the same day of the surgery. The third is a lab fabricated provisional restoration. So on the day of the implant placements, impressions are done, jaw relations are taken, and within the next couple of days, the lab fabricates the restoration, and then you place it over the implants. So going ahead, I'll discuss all these three treatment modalities. Let's begin first, with the first case which I plan to show, which is I would call it as the entry level case, something that which doesn't require too much of paraphernalia, too much of advanced imaging requirements, or some advanced lab support. So something which can be probably accomplished in most dental practices by an experienced clinician. So let's look at this situation. The plan is to give this patient a mandibular full arch restoration, which is going to be over four implants. Two of the implants are going to be tilted to increase the AP spread, and two implants are going to be placed straight. So the surgical phase entails reflecting a full thickness mucoperiosteal flap, identifying the mental nerves, and then using one of these visual guides, helping us to get the implants placed at the right angulation. So the two tilted implants here are being placed at 30 degrees. The implant again getting good primary stability as we place the implants, the two distal implants. The two central implants are going to be straight and parallel to each other. Those are the four implants in place. You can appreciate the adequate anteroposterior spread here that we have achieved. Then this will help us to verify the inclinations. These are the 30 degree inclinations, which will help us to choose the multi-unit abutments for that particular implant. So multi-unit abutment is fixed on the day of the implant placement. So these are the two multi-unit abutments for the distal implants, which will correct the 30 degrees tilt that we have given the implants. And the two straight multi-units, which are 0 degrees, which will be placed over the two straight implants in the center. The healing caps are placed over it. As you can see in this, the two 0 degrees multi-unit abutments in the center and the two 30 degree multi-unit abutments. Suturing is done. After that, this is the prosthetic shell, or it could be the patient's existing denture. We use that denture to just get the exact locations. So using some kind of a elastomeric material, we first get the four locations marked on the denture. Based on that, drill holes into the denture and hollow it out, which will coincide with the locations of the four implants. We then need to use these components. These are temporary titanium cylinders. They are abutments which will get placed over the implants. Once those abutments are placed, the holes are blocked with some Teflon, and then we verify that the denture seats passively over these over the alveolar ridge, so as to find these four abutments emerging out from the four holes that we have created. Once that's done, an adhesive is applied on the inner side of the denture, and then a self-cured resin is used inside the denture, and then placed over the four titanium abutments that we have placed. Once the material sets, the four internal screws are then loosened, and then the denture is taken out. So as soon as the denture is removed, the four titanium cylinders get picked up in the denture, and it's now fully seated in that particular denture in the right position. From here on, the lab work begins. You need to do a little bit of addition of, cold cure acrylic resin to fill up all the voids. And finally, the flanges of the dentures are completely eliminated. The buccal and lingual flanges are removed. The cantilevers are reduced. The underside is made completely convex. So the convex underside is a very important design aspect of the provisional restoration. Using the prosthetic screw, the denture is now fixed over the four implants. It's been torqued now at 15 Newton centimeters. So the implants initially achieve a primary stability of anywhere between 30 to 40 Newton centimeters. And the provisional denture gets fixed over those abutments at about 15 to 15 Newton centimeters. So as you see, a nice design over here with an open underside so that the patient can maintain good hygiene. That's the radiograph of the case after it's fully finished. So what is the advantage of this particular concept? The biggest advantage is that it is a one-day, one-appointment concept. So the patient gets a fixed denture on the same day as the implant placement. So from the patient's point of view, this is very, very fulfilling. It's also quite inexpensive. If you see, you don't really require very advanced tools. Most of them are very basic tools and equipment that most implantologists will have in their practices. However, there are many disadvantages in this. One is that it is extremely time intensive. It takes quite a lot of chairside time to be able to place the implants and convert the denture to a fixed denture and deliver to the patient. So again, for slightly elderly patients, this becomes very challenging. Lack of accuracy, because the surgery is done freehand. The denture is prefabricated and somehow modified and placed over the implants. Not a very accurate way of doing it. The other biggest disadvantage of this technique is that the denture that is converted and fixed over the implants is actually quite weak. Weak because firstly it is acrylic, and secondly because we have made massive holes in the denture to accommodate the components, and that weakens the overall structure, and at times this can lead to fractures during the healing phase. So it's quite prone to breakages, after the provisional has been placed and even before the implants start to osseointegrate. And that in immediate loading of full arch restorations is perhaps the most dreaded complication for the implantologist. So, but however said, whatever said and done, this is something which can be practiced like almost anywhere as long as the clinician is fully aware of the limitations of this technique. And of course, the clinician is experienced enough to pull off doing the surgery as well as the restoration on the same surgical appointment. Let's look at a case from the other end of the spectrum now. This is state of the art. This is kind of as good as it gets. So this is a case of a edentulous maxilla wherein all the initial CVCT planning was done, and based on the prosthetic plan, a surgical stent was fabricated, and using the surgical stent, flapless implant placements were done. There was a prefabricated screw retained prosthesis which the lab had fabricated. And then on placement of the implant, the prosthesis went in immediately, the occlusal adjustments were done, and the patient was rehabilitated on the same day itself. The advantages of something like this is, of course, it's prosthesis given on the same appointment, same day. It's highly accurate. It's a very sturdy prosthesis because it's prefabricated by the lab, and like the earlier case, you don't need to really make those holes inside the prosthesis to hollow it out, which in the end weakens the prosthesis. The disadvantages are that it's technologically driven. It's technology which is not easily available to everyone, particularly in our country. Same with the lab support. So you may not necessarily have the same level of lab support across the entire nation. It's also more expensive compared to the previous denture conversion case that we saw. So this is a third case, which is somewhat of a in between the two. It's a bit of a compromise between a fully a free hand and a guided surgery. So maybe, you know, we can call it semi-guided surgery, wherein we use a surgical stent to get us to follow the prosthetic plan of getting implants in the ideal prosthetically driven position. But that is done only with the help of the pilot drill. So this is the edentulous maxilla. That's how it looks. That's the surgical stent. And using the pilot drill, we go ahead, initially in a flapless manner, go to the full length of the implant that is proposed to be placed at those locations. And once the pilot drill has gone through, we then discard the stent and then go ahead, raise the flap, identify the locations. As you can see over here, these are the locations of that were made with the pilot drill using the stent. Next step is to then widen the osteotomy. Now this is again an advantage of this approach is, in case this is a case with a slightly compromised bone, and the plan is to use the osteodensification principle to widen the osteotomy sites and place the implants in order to get good primary stability, that can be achieved with this kind of a combination method. So the implants were placed as per the plan. Those were the six implants with good primary stability, following which the multi-unit abutments are topped on the implants at 30 Newton centimeters. Those are all the multi-unit abutments. After the suturing is done, the next step is the denture conversion. Like we saw in the first case, this is the patient's maxillary denture. The screws are all hollowed out, the dentures hollowed out to accommodate the titanium abutments. So those are the titanium abutments over the six implants emerging through the holes. And then this denture pickup is done using a resin material. So the resin material helps to pick it up. The denture is now out of the mouth. The next step is to trim off all the flanges, remove the palatal extension of the denture, remove the cantilevers, and then give it a nice smooth convex intaglio surface. This screw retained denture is now placed over the implants. The occlusal adjustments are done, and the patient is accordingly rehabilitated. This is an image soon after the procedure, and an immediate post-operative radiograph. As you can well see, the two distal implants, which are bypassing the maxillary sinuses on both sides at 30 degrees angulation as per the initial plan. Now, the advantages of this approach is that it's a one-appointment case, so the patient gets the dentures on the same day. It's accurate because we've used the stent for initial guidance. Its disadvantage is that it is quite time intensive. So again, trying to convert the denture on the same appointment and delivering it to the patient takes away a whole lot of time. Because the holes are made like we saw in case one, it's a much weaker prosthesis, very prone to fractures and breakages during the healing phase. You know, often patients report with such situations wherein, they are dentate. So we need to actually take the teeth out, place the implants, and then give the patient a fixed restoration. Now, the slight change in the initial plan here is that because the teeth are existing, we do not really require a radiographic guide as we needed in the previous cases. Because the teeth locations will help the clinician to guide as to where the implants need to be positioned. A surgical stent could also be, could be an optional step. You could do away without a surgical stent because, again, the roots of the teeth are present, which will again help the clinician in aligning the implants as per the prosthetic plan. But of course, clinicians are free to go ahead and use a surgical stent if it's going to be of help in getting the implants in its right position. What is required is the prosthetic shell that will help in converting it chair side from a removal denture to a fixed one. So let me share with you this case. This is a case of freehand placement into the extraction sockets for a dentate patient. followed by a lab fabricated provisional. So here is something different, wherein we are not going to be giving the patient a fixed denture on the same day, but we will have a lab fabricated prosthesis. So this is how the case goes. This is the patient's lower dentition. As you can see, it's all failing teeth. We go ahead and do the extractions under local anesthesia. And then after curettage of the sockets, we go ahead and place implants into the extraction sockets. Six straight implants were placed as parallel as possible to each other. Once the implants are placed, once we've achieved good primary stability and we are satisfied with the primary stability on the implants, the next step is to now torque the multi-unit abutments. So the multi-unit abutments get torqued over the implants, again at 30 Newton centimeters. These are protective caps over the multi-unit abutments. Suturing is done around it. Now, the next step is instead of doing a chair-side denture conversion, what we are doing here is actually taking a close-tray impression of the implants. So, close-tray impression is taken over here because the implants are reasonably parallel to each other. Had there been any issue with some angulations, then maybe an open-tray impression technique would have been preferred. But here we did a close-tray impression along with polyether impression material. That's the impression with the implant replicas attached into the impression. At the same time, in the same appointment, we also record a jaw relation. So a tentative jaw relation record is made, and that along with the impression is sent to the laboratory. So in the laboratory, the first step is the master cast is fabricated. Then with the jaw relation record, the casts are mounted onto the articulator. Now the laboratory fabricates the lower screw retained prosthesis. For that, they could do it entirely in acrylic if it's going to be a short term solution. But if it's going to be a slightly medium term or slightly longer term solution, they could reinforce it with a metal framework and then acrylize it and provide us with a screw retained restoration. Again, observe the underside of the screw retained restoration is again convex, highly polished, easy to maintain. And that's the advantage of again having it fabricated in the lab, is that you get a much better finished product compared to what we would do chair side. We see the patients, a patient in 48 hours, that's how the healing is. As you can appreciate, good tissue healing around the cover screws. Once those cover caps are removed, the screw retained restoration is now torqued over the multi-unit abutments at 15 Newton centimeters. Occlusal adjustments are done so as to achieve uniform contacts across the arch. That's the immediate post-operative radiograph, and that's how it looks in the mouth at 48 hours after the initial surgery. So, all in, this patient was quite satisfied with this outcome. The advantage is in this type of a case is that you have a fairly high degree of accuracy. You get a very sturdy prosthesis because it has been fabricated in the lab. At times, these prostheses can also be used for a medium-term solution if there is some kind of an intraoral welding or some kind of a metal framework that has gone along with the fabrication of the prosthesis. There's lesser chair-side time over here because the entire step of converting the denture into a fixed prosthesis chair site is avoided. Especially for much elderly patients, this turns out to be more comfortable. The disadvantages, for some who are really keen on having the prosthesis fixed on the same day, this is a bit of a disadvantage that it does take 1 to 3 days for the lab to turn around and deliver the prosthesis to us. Some clinical recommendations based on what I have just spoken so far. So, for most practices, I would imagine in our country, something like I just showed you the semi-guided approach of using the pilot drill guide us get the implants in the right positions and angulations, followed by a lab fabricated provisional restoration like I showed you in the last case, could be a great combination to treat and rehabilitate a lot of these edentulous patients. In remote locations, as the challenges get more, with the availability of technology and lab support, something like I showed in case one, which is the freehand surgery along with visual guides, and followed by a chair-side dentcha conversion would probably be a better option, or I must say most possible option in these slightly remote locations in our country. And needless to say, wherever technology is available in high-end practices, clinicians could very well opt for the guided surgery concepts with prefabricated prostheses going into the patient's mouth on the day of the implant placement. But what next now? The provisional is done, and now we have to move on to doing the final prosthesis. And this is something that we have been doing for the last 3 years following this protocol of actually fast-tracking the entire implant prosthetic workflow. And instead of the conventional 6 to 7 appointments, we are trying to do these cases in the shortest possible period. And we published this in 2018 in Compendium, this particular technique of fast-tracking the implant prosthodontics and reducing the chairside time and number of appointments to only one appointment. So this is a representative case of that technique. Let's start off with this point itself. This is a case where the immediate loading was done over 4 implants. The provisional prosthesis was made. The patient reports back after about 3 months after the implants have osseointegrated. Before we undo the prosthesis, we first record an interocclusal record, check the patient's jaw relation. The next step is to take the prosthesis out, look at the health of the implants, and once all that is found satisfactory, we go into with the impression step. Now, for the impression step, we attach this same denture to the underlying implants using the long screws of the open trays. So the open tray impression coping has a long screw, and that can be inserted through the titanium abutment channel to engage the underlying implants. A regular pickup impression is made with the help of polyether impression material, and the denture is picked up just like we do an open tray impression technique. So the denture gets picked up, and the model is poured in the clinic itself. So we attach the analogs, and the master cast is produced. In the clinic itself, what we do is we take the patient's provisional prosthesis, fix it over the master cast, mount it against the opposing dentition cast, and this is all is accomplished in the clinic itself. So once this step is done, the next step is to now make a labial index. So the labial index is made so that the lab gets the reference of the incisal edge position of the provisional denture. Now, if you realize what we have achieved in this one step is that we have taken the patient's final impression with the help of which we have made the master cast. We also have the patient's jaw relation record exactly the way it was, in the mouth with the provisional restoration. And we also have the labial index, which will help the lab to understand the labial position of the teeth and the incisal edge position. Once that is done, the prosthesis is put back into the patient's mouth, and the patient is now free to use the prosthesis over the next few weeks while the job is being dispatched to the lab, and the lab is going to take the next few weeks to fabricate the final prosthesis. So once the final prosthesis is delivered, we simply remove the screw retained provisional and replace it with the definitive restoration, which again in our experience has been a highly accurate way of managing these situations. So typically this is the workflow that we tend to follow. We do the initial implant placements, do the provisional restorations either on the day or lab fabricated within 72 hours over the implants. And once the provisional is done, after the implants have also integrated, go ahead directly to the final restoration, which is by fast tracking technique. And literally in about 4 appointments, we are able to rehabilitate most of these edentulous patients with a good, sturdy, screw-retained restoration. So with that, some concluding remarks. Immediate loading has a high success rate in literature if the right cases are chosen and executed well. Guided surgeries do offer benefits. Guided surgeries going to be the future of full arch implant restorations. However, you know, as we see the limitations in our country with the availability of that technology, we still have the other options open for fabricating these screw-retained immediate restorations. So lap fabrication will reduce a lot of chairside time, make it far more comfortable for the clinician and the patients, like the cases that I demonstrated. One thing that we have to be mindful of is that when we are looking at these full arch cases, the stakes are quite high. Also, the expectation of the patients are quite high. And for whatever reason, if there is a failure, it can be quite damaging to the, not just to the reputation of the clinician, but also in terms of the financial repercussions, it can be quite damaging. So one has to be quite mindful of that situation. Fast tracking is really a game changer for us, you know, to convert the provisional to the final in the shortest possible time without any compromise on the end result. But the last conclusion is that, you know, immediate loading, especially for full arch restorations, is not for everyone. It's not a beginner level treatment option. It is not for the novice clinician. But yeah, once you have gained your experience in all forms of implant dentistry, this is definitely a viable treatment plan for all our patients. So with that, I thank all of you for being attentive and attending this this online lecture. Feel free to send me a feedback about the lecture on this email ID, or if you feel free to even you know, maybe discuss a specific case scenario if there has been. Thank you very much.